Chapter 18 of Among the Meadow People. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Among the Meadow People by Clara Dillingham Pearson. Chapter 18. The Dignified Walking Sticks. Three walking sticks from the forest had come to live in the big maple tree near the middle of the meadow. Nobody knew exactly why they had left the forest, where all their sisters and cousins and aunts lived. Perhaps they were not happy with their relatives. But then, if one is a walking stick, you know, one does not care so very much about one's family. These walking sticks had grown up the best way they could, with no father or mother to care for them. They had never been taught to do anything useful, or to think much about other people. When they were hungry, they ate some leaves, and never thought what they should eat the next time that they happened to be hungry. When they were tired, they went to sleep, and when they had slept enough, they awakened. They had nothing to do but to eat and sleep, and they did not often take the trouble to think. They felt that they were a little better than those meadow people who rushed and scrambled and worked from morning until night, and they showed very plainly how they felt. They said it was not genteel to hurry, no matter what happened. One day the tree frog was under the tree when the large brown walking stick decided to lay some eggs. He saw her dropping them carelessly around on the ground and asked, "Do you ever fix a place for your eggs?"
"A place?" said the brown walking stick, waving her long and slender feelers to and fro. "A place? Oh, no. I think they will hatch where they are. It is too much trouble to find a place."
"Pucker up," said the tree frog. "Some others do not think it too much trouble to be careful where they lay eggs."
"That may be," said the brown walking stick, "but they do not belong to our family." She spoke as if those who did not belong to her family might be good but could never be genteel. She had once told her brother, the five-legged walking stick, that she would not want to live if she could not be genteel. She thought the meadow people very common. The five-legged walking stick looked much like his sister. He had the same long, slender body, the same long feelers, and the same sort of long, slender legs. If you had passed them in a hayfield, you would surely have thought each a stem of hay, unless you happened to see them move. The other walking stick, their friend, was younger and green. You would have thought her a blade of grass. It is true that the brother had the same kind of legs as his sister, but he did not have the same number. When he was young and green, he had six. Then came a dreadful day when a hungry nuthatch saw him, flew down, caught him, and carried him up a tree. He knew just what to expect, so when the nuthatch set him down on the bark to look at him, he unhooked his feet from the bark and tumbled to the ground. The nuthatch tried to catch him and broke off one of his legs, but she never found him again, although she looked and looked and looked and looked. That was because he crawled into a clump of ferns and kept very still. His sister came and looked at him and said, "Now, if you were only a spider, it would not be long before you would have six legs again." Her brother waved first one feeler and then the other and said,
"Do you think I would be a spider for the sake of growing legs? Of course I would rather be a walking stick without any legs than to be a spider with 100.
Of course, you know, spiders never do have 100, and the walking stick wouldn't be walking without any. But that was just his way of speaking, and it showed what kind of insect he was. His relatives all waved their feelers, one at a time, and said, "Ah, he has the true walking stick spirit." Then they paid no more attention to him, and after a while he and his sister and their green little friend left the forest for the meadow. On the day when the grass was cut, they had sat quietly in their trees and looked genteel. Their feelers were held quite close together, and they did not move their feet at all, only swayed their bodies gracefully from side to side. Now they were on the ground, hunting through the flat piles of cut grass for some fresh and juicy bits to eat. The tree frog was also out, sitting in a cool, damp corner of the grass rows. The young grasshoppers were kicking up their feet. The ants were scrambling around as busy as ever, and life went on quite as though neither men nor horses had ever entered the meadow.
"See," cried a spider who was busily looking after her web, "there comes a horse drawing something, and the farmer sitting on it and driving."
When the horse was well into the meadow, the farmer moved a bar, and the queer-looking machine began to kick the grass this way and that with its many stiff and shining legs. A frisky young grasshopper kicked in the same way, and happened, just happened, of course, to knock over two of his friends. Then there was a great scrambling, and the crickets frolicked with them. The young walking stick thought it looked like great fun and almost wished herself some other kind of insect, so that she could tumble around in the same way. She did not quite wish it, you understand, and would never have thought of it if she had turned brown.
"Ah," said the five-legged walking stick, "what scrambling! How very common!"
"Yes, indeed," said his sister. "Why can't they learn to move slowly and gracefully? Perhaps they can't help being fat, but they might at least act genteel."
"What is it to be genteel?" asked a grasshopper suddenly.
He had heard every word that the walking stick said.
"Why," said the five-legged walking stick, "it is just to be genteel, to act as you see us act, and to—"
Just here the hay tedder passed over them, and every one of the walking sticks was sent flying through the air and landed on his back. The grasshoppers declared that the walking sticks tumbled and kicked and flopped around in a dreadfully common way until they were right side up.
"Why," said the measuring worm, "you act like anybody else when the hay tedder comes along."
The walking sticks looked very uncomfortable, and the brother and sister could not think of anything to say. It was the young green one who spoke at last.
"I think," said she, "that it is much easier to act genteel when one is right side up."
End of chapter 18.